Hello, John. My name is Uday Kapoor. As you know, I've known you for all these years. In fact, you hired me at Sun. So welcome to the oral history interview.
Thank you.
Your full name is John Charles Shoemaker. You were born October 11th, 1942, in Rochester, New York. So we'd like to start with your early life. Did you grow up in Rochester?
I did. My family moved up to Rochester, New York from, I'm half Dutch, half German. My family on the Dutch side moved up to Rochester in around 1800. They had actually been in New Amsterdam before it was New York, and the southern tip of where Wall Street is now, and Battery Park. And actually up until the mid 1940s, 50s, they had legal claim to part of that area of Manhattan, but were never successful. As you can imagine, there were deep pockets on the other side. But then in 1800, my family arrived in Rochester, which was actually considered the first frontier town, believe it or not. And have been there ever since. So I'm really the first person to leave Rochester. My father was one of 10 children, my mother also was, you know, a member of a large family, and they were German, spoke German in their home. My grandmother lived with us, so I grew up on German cooking, it kind of had a normal, you know, childhood. Went through public schools, graduated. I lived in a town called Brighton, which is a suburb of Rochester, and I graduated from Brighton High School. I played a lot of sports in high school. I guess an interesting early life thing would be that I spent a lot of time on athletics and probably less time studying than I should have. And my senior year in high school, against my basketball coach's wishes, I went snow ski racing up in Vermont, trying out for the preliminaries to get to the Olympic trials. And in the middle of a race, I broke both my legs, spiraled one ankle very badly. Because of that, I lost a basketball scholarship to college. And I was going to Bucknell and couldn't go because I had to drop. I was in bed for 6 months with my legs up in the air. Had to drop all my science lab courses and so forth. And they said, you can come in a year, but you need to go someplace else for a year and make up all this stuff. So the principal of my high school knew the president of a college called Hanover College and said, this was literally the summer, a month before school was going to start. And he said, could you take him for a year? If he recovers, he'll be a good athlete. If not, he'll leave in a year. He's a good guy, and it would help us out because of what happened to him. They took me. I went there. Couldn't play sports, and a really funny thing happened to me. I was bored because I was so used to spending a lot of time on sports that I started to study. And when I started to study, I found out that I was pretty smart, which I had never really realized. And so, make a long story short, I ended up president of my fraternity, dean's list, and got a fellowship to go to graduate school, and kind of changed my life. The other major thing that changed it because of that accident was that I flunked my physical and didn't go to Vietnam. So although I've had to suffer with, you know, bad ankle and so forth, it may in fact be preferable to probably dying in Vietnam. So, you know, life has its compensations, I guess.
So what were your favorite subjects in school?
In high school?
Yeah.
I liked math. I liked sciences, more geology, that kind of a thing. And I liked history. I think those are probably.
So going to Hanover College, how did you select the subjects and so on?
Well, it's a liberal arts school.
Right.
So there is a core curriculum. And then at some point you choose a major. And honestly, I kind of went back and forth between different things. I'd like to say I was one of these people who just knew what he wanted to do and did it, but that was, as we go through this, you'll learn that was not true with me. So I ended up, I just had interest, and then I'd say, if I'm interested in this, what kind of fits it? And I ended up with multiple majors. I did a political science major, a business major, and I had math and geology minors. As I said, I became a Sigma Chi, was president of my chapter. I was very active in that. It was a very good fraternity there at that time. In fact, all 30 members of my fraternity that graduated with me went on to master's and PhDs, which is pretty amazing, really, when you think about it. And they're very accomplished people now. So I think that I was fortunate at that time to just become associated with these kinds of people. I think they have made a big impact on my own mental attitude and outlook as I was kind of going through this problem phase. Right.
Did your father or mother have an influence?
My father was worked for Eastman Kodak. He was actually one of the guys that at that time came up with the, people nowadays probably don't remember, but Kodak cameras back in the 50s and 40s, 50s, 60s had leather on them, but it was artificial. Mm-hmm. Well, he invented all that stuff. And
right.
And that was kind of what he did, and he worked at Kodak Park, which was an amazing place back in the 1950s. Rochester had about 250,000 residents, 50,000 people worked for Kodak. So if you figure four people to a family, pretty much tells you.
Right.
And Kodak Park was 3 miles long, had its own railroad, had its own truck fleet, everything. It was an amazing place. Mm.
So did he was happy with your selection of your career?
So one of the traumatic experiences that I suffered early in life, I think, I really believe, and maybe it's because of things that I've been through, but I really believe that people who have never had a really difficult situation to get through don't have the same resiliency later in life in terms of when they face the next difficult thing. And the thing that I faced was my father passed away from a heart attack very suddenly when I was 17 years old. He was extremely healthy. He had played golf that day. He had this heart attack, and basically they put him in the hospital and he laid there for 2 weeks and he died because medical science at that point in time didn't know what to do. I've talked to many cardiologists since. I have a daughter who's a doctor, and they say that if that had occurred today, he'd have been in and out of there in 24 hours, had a stent, and lived along 20 mm-hmm. more years. So, but that changed our lives dramatically.
It's been a traumatic experience for you.
So in a period of, I broke my legs in December. I was in bed for 5 months. First time I walked was to get my high school diploma, walking across the stage. My father was there. 2 weeks later, he died of a heart attack. Mm. My mother carried on. She was an incredibly strong person. And I had to earn my way through college. We had no money, so I worked multiple jobs. In fact, I worked at Kodak Park. I loaded trucks. I did anything I could do to make the most money I could just make.
You had siblings?
And that got through there.
You had siblings too?
I had a brother who was only 13. So I was 17, he was 13, and there we were. So, and we were, basically not a, we didn't have any inherited wealth or anything like that. So we just had to kind of battle our way.
Right.
And I always remember the day my mother handed me, when I got out of college, she handed me a check for $500, and she said, "That's it, you're on your own." And go make what you can of it.
So then you moved on to Indiana University, I understand. How did that happen?
Yes, I was fortunate to get a fellowship and so forth there. At that point, I was deciding between law school and business school, and I was accepted at Cornell to do their program that you get a combined 5-year program, and I was accepted at Virginia. But again, I had no money, and Indiana gave me both a fellowship and an assistantship. So I went there, I got an MBA, then I they encouraged me to stay, and I went out and worked for a year, and I came back, and I did a couple years toward a doctorate, but I never finished my dissertation. And that was actually in political science and government. And it was the interaction of the federal government with the private sector. And I looked at things like the Federal Reserve System and so forth. And then I went back and found and got my first full-time job, which was in New York City. I was selected for a small group of people who did work for a company called Container Corporation of America, and I did programs for combination marketing, packaging, and so forth for major consumer brands. Things like Shell Pest Strips, liquor business, cosmetics, and so forth, where the package actually was more valuable than the product, believe it or not. And I went through this intensive sales and marketing training and actually had Marshall McLuhan come in and train us, which was pretty amazing. And I was with them, oh gosh, about a year or so, and it just wasn't my thing. I didn't find it interesting, and so I ended up, and this is where I think to somebody's earlier question, but this is, you can see that I was pretty flexible trying to figure out what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
So then I ended up going down to the Bahamas, and Grand Bahama Island in the mid-1960s had just had a deal done. Two people, a guy named Ludwig, and I'm trying to remember the other guy's name. He was a shipping tycoon, bigger than Onassis. They had done a deal, 250 square miles of Grand Bahama Island, called Freeport-Lakaya. They got a 99-year lease. And they had a holding company called the Port Authority. And they owned the taxi cab company, the construction company, all the retail. If you want to be a doctor or lawyer on the island, you could come there and pay £100 for a license and so forth. And I wandered in there and they hired me, and I structured the whole organization, all the business systems, accounting, human resources, and so forth, helped them create a strategy. And I was there about a year or so, and I got what they call rock fever, and I had to get out of there. And so I came back, and that was when I first started getting into tech. And I took a job with the General Dynamics Electronics Division in Rochester, and they were building the aerospace ground support equipment, maintenance support systems for the F-111 airplane. Mm-hmm. And I led a team that planned all of that, and I really enjoyed it. The airframe was being built in Fort Worth. And we were on an impossible schedule to get this thing out and over to Vietnam. And the specifications for it were very, very difficult because they wanted it to be able to land and take off from an aircraft carrier. They wanted it to be a fighter. They wanted it to be a bomber. They wanted it to be able to carry a Phoenix missile system. It was movable swept wing configuration. And We had that was my first time I realized that how much it would be wonderful if we had a lot more computer technology, because we were literally trying to build this thing, get the ECOs through, because everything we did affected the airframe, and we had fax, we had Bruning smelly copiers, and we would be sending things overnight, flying, you know, all the latest changes back and forth. And we finally got about 30 of these planes over to Vietnam, and anybody that was alive then will remember that they all crashed. Mm-hmm. It was a complete disaster. And so we had to rebuild from that. I was here about 2 years. And then I think probably most people know, but Rochester was where Xerox was founded and also where Eastman Kodak was founded. And it was a very high-tech town, almost like a little Silicon Valley type mm-hmm. place, really.
Right.
And it had the University of Rochester, the Strong Memorial Hospital, Medical School. You know, it was a very high-tech place. And I was fortunate to get job offers from Kodak, Xerox, and IBM, and I wanted to go to Xerox. But Xerox was, in those days, a very hot, fast-growth, no-control startup.
And you chose to go to Xerox because it was in close by?
It was, yeah, and I had job offers from the others, but Xerox never got me the offer letter. And I finally called them and I said, I'm going to go work for Kodak if you guys don't give me an offer letter. And so they did. They had a guy drive it out to my house, and I accepted the job and ended up being at Xerox for the next 20 years. Mm-hmm. But it was very interesting.
Yeah. So this is Doug Fairbairn. Did you go there because of the job or because of the company? What was the draw about going to Xerox?
The company. It just, you know, I had worked 5 summers at Kodak. It was very interesting, and IBM was very much this way. When I went to Kodak and interviewed, they actually had an employment folder on the desk that had my whole history as a summer employee. I was shocked at that. How could they actually have this, right? I went to IBM. It was so structured. And, you know, you just felt like, I don't know what. I went to Xerox. They said, we don't really have, I said, well, like, what's the job? You know, and they, we don't really have job descriptions. You can do what you want. You know, I can expand as far as you want to go. It reminded me a lot of a place I worked later in my life called Sun. I said, this sounds great. So I took it. And it was very similar to Sun in a lot of ways. Super smart people, creative people, the whole business model, everything. They were the first, they were the fastest growth company to $1 billion. And if you go back to mid late 1960s, early 70s, Xerox was the hottest company on the planet.
Yeah, it was a very hot company.
So you joined as a financial analyst?
I joined in pricing and strategy analysis, which is in retrospect, I was very fortunate to have had that happen to me, pure happenstance. But when Chester Carlson discovered, you know, the Xerox electrostatic process, and they built this over the next 10 years or so, they went around and Joe Wilson attempted to get money from IBM, Kodak, and all these places, buy his company. They wouldn't touch him. So they self-funded it. It was a startup, basically. And when they got the first machine built, it was very big. It was very slow, and everybody did carbon paper, and they'd look at this thing and they go, why would I, pay $20,000 for one of these? So DataQuest did a market projection. And they said, at most, forever, you'll sell 5,000 of these in the world. And everybody went, this isn't gonna hunt. And so my little pricing group I was in, I wasn't the leader of it, but came up with a thing called rental pricing. And we charged a nominal use charge and so much a copy. So we take one of these machines and we say, we'll put this in your office, pay us $25 a month. If you don't make a copy on it, that's all you pay. And each time you make a copy, you give us a nickel. And these people are going, good, sounds like a good deal to me. And that was the secret sauce, and it took off. From there on, it's history, but rental pricing, leasing pricing, all the creative pricing strategies combined with the patent portfolio that Xerox developed was basically the fundamental reasons for their success. And I think in a lot of ways, they are a precursor to Silicon Valley. They are were a very high-tech company that actually had many different technologies in their products. And as time went forward, they had paper handling, optics, all kinds of physics technologies, materials technology, toner developer, and then as time passed, and the transistor was invented and so forth, they were actually one of the first companies to utilize those things at an era before any of these things were commercially available. They designed their old VLSI architecture. They fabbed their own chips. Did everything. Total vertical integration.
So how did your career advance within Xerox?
Really honestly, at a personal level, I was shocked how well I did. I never thought of myself as some guy who was going to shoot up the corporate ladder. I truly did not. In fact, when I was at General Dynamics, I got my first performance review, and the guy who, I'm not going to say names, but the guy who was my boss sat me down, told me I did a good job on this and that. But he said, you know, I want to caution you. I don't think what you have what it's going to ever take to be in management. So don't set your goals too high. I said, thank you. Anecdotally, about 10 years later, this guy, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but this guy worked for me two levels down at Xerox. And he was a great friend, but he never forgot it. We used to laugh about it all the time. So my career in Xerox was amazing. It was a terrific career. I have nothing negative to say. I moved from pricing, and they were just gotten the company to a size where they were beginning to develop multiple products. And so we created for the first time a program management system, a matrix organization, program planning and analysis. We used PMS 360. And I built this whole organization to manage multiple developments, product development activities. And we brought in people from, we brought in a guy who had done the planning for some of the space program out of NASA. And a couple guys from RCA who had done things, and we built this whole thing out and created business units for the first time. And so I evolved into that.
So you went from a financial pricing kind of thing to a product management.
Exactly,
product,
just like that. And after about, so that would have probably been the mid-70s, they moved me over into strategy. And they created a new position called Director of Electronic Reprographic Strategy. And my job, and this was my very first taste of moving towards a systems business. And my job was to begin to figure out what the strategy should be for the company and how the market for light lens copying and electronic printing or digitally generated images would merge, what the growth impacts on light lens copying would be. And as you can imagine, this is the heartland of Xerox, so they were very concerned about this. This is also part of the reason that they started investing in building Park out. And so I ended up with two bosses, one in Rochester, one in El Segundo, who hated each other and were on opposite sides of the argument. So I got that experience for a couple of years. And then they decided that I had more potential. And so for the first time ever, they took a person from headquarters and they moved me out to the field. And I became a vice president, region manager. And they promoted me to a corporate vice president. I was the youngest corporate vice president in Xerox history. Yeah. And I ran sales service, about 3,000 people, P&L, for a couple years in Detroit, the Midwest. When I came back, I was only there for a few weeks, and they said, I got this phone call, and it was a guy named Bob Adams, who was executive vice president and ran all the systems businesses for Xerox. And he said, I really need help. I've talked to David Kearns. I want you to come out. Who is the CEO? I want you to come out and be my chief of staff and figure this all out. I relocated to LA, and that's how I got to California. And I had I had an interesting compilation of organizations on. I mean, I had marketing, HR, finance, but then I also had the electronics division, and I had the Pomona board plant, and various things. So I really had everything that wasn't under either electronic printing business or document systems business. And I did that for a couple of years, and then they asked me to be in charge of document systems, and they moved me up to Silicon Valley. That was when I first had my very initial association with Sun. And my mission in that.
Before you get there, can I interrupt you? Can I take a step back? There's an important thing that happened at Xerox in 68-69. They bought Scientific Data Systems. And you were at Xerox at the time.
Yes.
Were you in any way involved or part of or close observer of that whole process?
And I was.
What was the, can you give me so an inside paid, view as to what
so they were,
this, what their goal was and that sort of thing?
Absolutely, yeah. Peter McCullough, who was CEO, chairman, renowned, famous business executive, had a vision called Office of the Future. He believed that, he was very visionary, and he believed that there would be, he didn't know any of the details, but at a point in the future, he could see, you know, the transistor hadn't been invented at that time, computer companies were springing up. He could see that Xerox needed to somehow play in this, and that he had a wider vision for the strategy of the company and the mission of the company. He was all, that was also why he was the driving force behind PARC, mm-hmm. the formation of PARC. And so they identified scientific data systems, and they paid $1 billion in cash for it. What's really interesting to me was there was testimony to how little knowledge there was within the Xerox East Coast executive management team of the system business or computer technology, is the fact that they thought they could take that company and make it a commercial computer company that would compete in enterprise accounts against IBM and so forth. When, you know, anybody technical knows that this was a purely scientific computer product with a completely different architecture, set of objectives and so forth. And so that never really came to be. That mission that they had, you know, in their vision, their Peter's vision, never came to be. Mm-hmm. And I've always assumed he got some bad staff work on it. But what did evolve out of it that actually made it, in retrospect, for reasons other than those that they, I think, were thinking about, was that it, that actually ended up becoming a critical part of the electronic printing business, which ended up, you know, growing to be a multiple billion-dollar business, mm-hmm. and moved Xerox into the data center with 8.5 by 11 cut sheet duplex printing, which knocked out a lot of IBM printers. And as a laser technology progressed and reliability got better and cost came down, became a very profitable business for Xerox.
Mm-hmm. All right. So anyway, you were describing.
So I walked into this. I don't want to use four-letter words, but I walked into this situation with the system, with coming up here and looking at where Xerox was, and they were losing $300-400 million a year. They had a whole, all of the PARC work, and they had a completely proprietary business right when open systems were taken off. So if you start at the very bottom, they had a proprietary chipset. They had a proprietary language called Pilot. They operating system. They had a Mesa language. They had they built their own. They fabbed their own chips. They were building their own hardware. They're building the chips, building the boards, building the workstations, and.
This is the Star workstation.
It's our workstation. It was just a disaster. Now they had, but they through PARC they had vision. They had amazing first, third gen software, icon based, mouse and all that. So, what happened with me personally was we went through, looked at it, and said we've got to just transform this whole thing. This isn't a matter of, you know, cutting cost and figuring out how to make this whole. Architecture successful, it's never going to happen. What we ended up doing was starting to work with Sun Microsystems, which was pretty small at that point in time, and we, bottom line, we moved, we closed down the all the hardware development. We OEM'd in Sun workstations, Xerox labeled them. We ported the Viewpoint software under Unix. We closed down the chip development. Opened up the whole thing, and through that process, we sold a whole ton of IOTs, image output terminals, to Sun, which they OEM'd, and they drove them out of their workstations. And we developed this very successful business alliance, and I worked with Wayne Rosing, Eric Schmidt, Scott a little bit, and so forth. And a guy named Bill Reduschel, who actually worked for me at Xerox and then went to Sun. And then over a period of 2 to 3 years, I worked so closely with them that they said, Xerox I was not that happy, and I was probably gonna have to move back to the East Coast and all this kind of stuff. So I made the decision, I said, why don't you just come work over here? So I didn't really go through any formal job search process or anything. I just went over there and they gave me a job offer and I took it. and started working there one day.
There were some interesting sidelines.
So what year was that?
That would have been the end of 89.
Yeah.
So I have a personal question just to interject here. When you were still at Xerox in early to mid 70s, they had a huge to-do in Boca Raton, Florida. They brought in sales and other people from all over the world to kind of get them rah-rah, because things were looking, you know, the copier business was in trouble at that point, and they wanted to get everybody pumped up about what the work that was being done at Park and what the future held. Were you part of that, or were you?
I was not at that. I would have been probably too junior for that at the time. I was, when they made me a corporate VP, they had equivalent offsite in the Bahamas. And I was at that. And I'll never forget that, because I walked in the room, and it was a tiered classroom environment. There were maybe only 40, there were, I think, 30 corporate officers. And I'm like below the most junior one. And I walked into this room, and I sat in the upper back corner chair. And Dave Kearns was CEO then, and he walks in, and he looks up, and he goes, "John, what are you doing up there? Come sit next to me." And I had to go down and sit in the front row next to him for this whole 2 days. And that just pays testimony to his charisma and leadership. The guy was an unbelievable guy. But a very funny thing happened. One of the key guys I brought to speak was Peter Drucker. And so I'm sitting next to Kearns in the front row, and Peter Drucker is doing his talk, and he holds up the thing called Xerox World, which was the company newspaper. And he holds the front page up, and he says, and there's a big headline and everything, he says, "So how many people," and it's got a column down the side, Dave Kearns' picture, CEO column, and said, "So how many people do you guys think read that?" And people go, "No, I don't know. Well, he says, "Not many." And then he flips it over, and he goes to the bottom right corner of the last page, like in the equivalent of six-point kanji, right? And he says, "You know what this is?" He says, "This is a list of everybody who's been promoted. How many people do you think read that?" You know, the obvious answer was everybody. Of course, Kearns is blushing in the front row. And he kind of turns to me and says, "Is that true, John?" I said, "Yeah, that's probably true." I always, you know how you have these little anecdotal things you remember in your life, right. And that was one I remember.
So
anyway, I keep distracting. Go
no,
ahead.
No,
those are all good. You remind
so,
me of things.
Maybe you can do a little bit of the story of how you came to Sun.
All right. So I knew Scott a little bit. I knew Wayne Rosing extremely well. I knew Eric Schmidt extremely well, and a few other guys. So couple things happened. First of all, I go over there. They fly me up, and they said, "Scott wants to go see Scott." So I go see Scott, and he doesn't even interview me. I don't want to mention everything we talk about, but it was very casual. And he says, "So don't worry about it. You know, I want you here. Get the right job." But he said, "There's one person on my staff who insists on interviewing you." And I said, "I bet I know who that is." "Yeah, Carol Bartz." And he goes, "Yep." And the reason was that about 3 years earlier, I was single. She was single. And we got Owen Brown fixed us up on a blind date. And Owen was briefly president of Sun, and he was also at Xerox. And so we went out, and we had a nice time. The Silicon Valley Ball was coming up, and I invited her to go to it. And then about 3-4 weeks or whatever before it, I had met my wife, and I said, "You know, Carol, I got to break the date because, you know." And she goes, "Oh, okay, bye." So before the Silicon Valley Ball, Don and I show up at Owen Brown's house for a cocktail party, and who walks in but Carol, alone with a beautiful new dress on, everything. And so this has been So she decided she'd interview me. So I went out there, and I knew what it was about. She's tough. She just ripped me for an hour, and it was all done. I said, well, okay, do you feel better? You know, is that good? Yeah. And so to make sort of the final thing, she later married a really cool guy, Bill Maher, and Bill and I are really good friends. And in fact, my kids would play with his daughter and stuff. So through the years, she left Sun after that and went to Autodesk and later Yahoo. But recently, people probably know, about a year or two ago, we had a Sun reunion. And Carol comes up to me and puts her arms around me and hugs me and says, "You're forgiven." That was pretty good.
I was there at that thing, but
story.
I didn't know that.
That was a funny story. So I went over, and next funny thing that happened, classic Sun Microsystems, was the night before I'm going to start work, I get a phone call. And it's a guy named Kevin Melia, who was EVP of Ops at that time. He was CFO and all that, and very senior guy. And he said, "Look, you got to watch here in the morning, but we're going to just put you temporarily in this job." And I said, "Well, what happened to the job you were going to give me?" And he said, "Well," this is sort of a continuation of the previous story, but he said, "Carol Bartz just got promoted from running service to running sales, and Bill Maher, her new husband, can't work for her. So we're going to put him in operations in this job, and we're going to put you in his job."
That was the job that you were going to get.
Yeah. And so that was how Bill and I actually ended up being friends. But when I look back now and I think about all those little things just coming into Sun, even before I got there, I'm going, this is a different kind of place. And the other thing that happened was they were convincing me, and I said, "Oh, I haven't made up my mind yet." So they had this huge VP offsite in Tahoe, and they said, "Just come up and attend it for 4 days." And they're going through, you know, all the secret stuff, strategy and everything. I'm not even an employee. "Hey, don't worry about it, you know." So about the second day, Reduchel and Scott sit me down, and they come over to dinner or something, and they say, "Well, what do you think? You like it?" I say, "Yeah, this is really cool. I like it. I'd like to come work here. But I think I'd like to take a couple of weeks or a month off and then I'll start." And they said, "Well, you know, that's okay, but that's a problem." "Why is that a problem?" "Because we started you on the payroll 10 years ago." And I said, "What?" "Yeah, we thought you'd take us. So we said, it was a good time to do it. So we just started you."
So while you're still working
well,
in
I was
Xerox?
I had terminated there.
You had terminated,
yeah.
Okay.
But so there was no legal problem with it. But
so we've done.
I had two other job opportunities. I was in the middle of.
So we've done some panel discussions with many of the early people.
Sure.
So we have captured a lot of the history of the early days of Sun. And so I'd like to find out, when you arrived at Sun, what were the conditions like? Because this is kind of an intermediate.
Great question. Another amazing experience. I walked into Sun as they were making a flying catch to save the company in a thing called Q489. And I'm sure many people know about this, but Q489, what happened was they tried to convert to a new computer system, ship a whole bunch of new products all at once, couldn't ship anything, couldn't book revenue, had no money, and at the last minute, Goldman Sachs stepped in through a lot of work by Bill Reduchel, who was acting CFO at that time, and gave us $60 million to save the company. So I literally walked in the door as this thing was going teetering, and then as I started working there, I had trepidation, you know, because Xerox had a really good reputation and everything, and, you know, goodwill. And I'll never forget, I came home from my first day at Sun. I went to my first meeting, and as I recall, it was something to do with AT&T, $50 million decision, 4 or 5 people in the room. No slot, no overheads, no anything. Everybody just yelled and screamed and argued with each other. And after like an hour, they said, "Well, let's do it." And everybody went, "Okay." And that was it. And I went home and I said, I mean, in Xerox, there would have been 3 weeks of preparatory slides. There would have been staff work. No one would have made a decision in the meeting.
Right.
Everybody would have put editorial comments into the minutes, and eventually someone would have, you know, made a decision. And I went home and I said to my, in spite of the wonderful career at Xerox, I said to my wife, my first day at Sun was better than any day I've ever had at Xerox. And that was kind of how it started. But then to your observation, Sun was just at the point where it was growing up. So you had all these brilliant, great people who were in the early days of Sun, but they also needed a new skill set, you know, seasoned people who had run big operations and knew how to do all that. And so there was a period there where this whole transition occurred and everybody's trying to, you know, figure out the right things to do. And we always talked about hiring, shooting ahead of the duck, which meant whoever we hire, we need somebody who's done something that's probably 2, 3, 4 times bigger than what we're asking them to do here. We need to attract them and tell them we're going there and we need your help to get there. So it was a very interesting, exciting time. And as you look at Sun a few years later, I think a perspective that many people perhaps don't understand is that everybody knows Sun had this exciting reputation, world's biggest startup, fun culture, Scott, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What they don't probably appreciate was that, I don't remember how many years in a row, but we were named the best financially managed tech company. And when you went under the covers of Sun, it was really well run. So it kind of had that aura, but at the same time, they knew what they were doing.
Right.
So that was pretty cool.
So I noticed
who was
that
responsible for that?
Okay. You know, there was a layer of people. I mean, I can give you names.
I don't get that Scott would have been.
No, he
would.
No, no, it wasn't.
So
Scott.
Who,
Scott was very smart, and he knew. He knew what he needed. But it was this whole layer of people, like the Mike Lehmans and Tom Meredith and myself and Masood Jabbar and you know on. This team of probably half a dozen people that were very professional managers and strong leaders, and they, you know, they really did it. And you know, I think, and not to flash ahead too far, but if you go ahead into the 2000 whatever 5, 6, when the company really never came back from the bubble, the bursting of the bubble, what you'll see is that those people were all gone, mm-hmm. and. I think the hole was too big. I think a big reason, you know, that the company wasn't quite able to pull out was that that leadership team really didn't. You know, Masood was gone. I was gone. Meredith went to Dell.
Mike Lehman was there for but
he came back. He left,
yes.
And he came
yes.
back because he wanted to try to help. Another one was George Reyes, and George went to Google. If you look at these people, and Xander went to Motorola, if you look at these people, say, wow, yeah, it's quite a team of people. You don't take a team of people like that out of a company and not expect something.
Right.
And then Scott, you know, retired. And
mm-hmm. So we'll come back to that.
You know, though Jonathan probably made mistakes, it was a lot more than that.
Yeah. So we'll come back to that theme.
Yeah.
But the one thing I noticed was that you also were chief quality officer for some time. What was the reason for that assignment?
Well, if you go way back in my background to my days at Xerox, did a huge strategic relationship with Fuji Photo Film and formulated Fuji Xerox. And Fuji Xerox was the first company to win the Deming Award in Japan. And I was on that team and brought leadership through quality and was a leader in leadership through quality at Xerox for many years. And so when I came to Sun, it wasn't why I came to Sun, but one of the things that I brought was that experience. So when the became clear that part of this transition to becoming a grown-up company was we needed a lot better processes. We needed a lot more focus on quality, whether that be in our products, whether that be in our service strategies, whether that be in our business processes. I began to play a role there. And so in addition to my job running computer system and worldwide operations and so forth, I had additional title, which was Chief Quality Officer, and I kind of oversaw that. And there was a lot of good synergy there because since I owned all hardware development, when we had problems, I was kind of in the middle of it from multiple perspectives. And I don't know how many people may remember a thing called eCash parity, but we had a horrendous technical problem that we knew what was causing it, but we didn't know how to stop it. And we almost destroyed the company with it because we had all these mission critical installations with E10Ks and mid-range servers, and we were having products go down, and we were spending hundreds of millions of dollars literally replacing products, boards, everything we could do. We had analysis going of trying to figure out the cause, and in the end it turned out it was actually an S-rant from IBM, and they were very cooperative. They were fabulous. They were a competitor at some levels, but they were our partner too. And we also sold a couple $100 million a year of systems through IBM Global Services at that time. So it was a very interesting, complicated, relationship. But we made the problem. One of my themes has always been make the problem the answer, and we made the problem the answer. What we did was I was asked by Scott and Ed to be the person in charge of solving this problem. And I said, okay, but what I want to do is I want authority to handpick a high potential, one of our best vice presidents to run for me each aspect of solving it. And so I got this team of people. And I got Kathleen Holmgren from Ops, I got Rich Green, I got Steve McKay, and so forth. And we met at 7 a.m. every morning. And they each had a team, and they went out. And one was responsible for software and patch management and how we managed that whole aspect of it. That was Rich. Kathleen was responsible for all the ops aspects of it. Steve, the technology aspects. And I had Paul Rochester, who worked the service part of it. And what we actually did was not only eventually solve the problem, but we remade all the processes of the company. So whereas for the first 6 to 9 months, I was spending all my time doing interviews with the Wall Street Journal and TV and everybody else, telling them, we're going to fix this. This is not Sun. Hang with us. I would fly to Japan to talk to a customer, get on the plane 4 hours later and fly back. That's how bad it was. Mm-hmm. 2 years later, they were coming and wanting to interview us because their customers were telling them, Sun has got the best processes and the best quality of any company that we work with. And we went from being in the doghouse to being considered a leadership in quality. And again, another aspect of that was the purchase of Cray from SGI, which gave us all of their data center knowledge, RAS-type knowledge, high-end quality process knowledge.
So going back to when you came to Sun, what were the product mixes, what was the strategy in terms of workstations, graphics, networking, Java, Solaris? Can you tell us?
You mean kind of the transition that occurred?
Right.
Sure. So when I got to Sun, it was a technical workstation company. The total TAM, available market, was probably $15 billion. Everybody knows the story of Open and Industry Santa Components and the Andy Bill Scott strategy and all that. But it became clear that if we were going to take this company to a bigger, broader mission, we need to go beyond that. But what we had done is built a really great company to serve the market we were serving and the class of customers we were serving. And that class of customers was basically technical people. And they didn't really worry a lot about high availability. They actually like to take the things apart themselves and put them back together. They were all doing mainly technical applications, computer design, and you know, all that kind of stuff. So when we started saying, well, you know, how do we move into the commercial marketplace, which is an infinitely larger market, we began to realize that we didn't have anything that we needed, basically. And so I really view Sun's transformation from a technical workstation company to a true broad-based systems company, you know, one of the great S-curve, in a way, transitions that has occurred, because everything was different. So what we basically did was we achieved a point in time around 1995 where we said, okay, we're going into multiple businesses, and we completely restructured the company from a functional organization to business units. So we set up a workstation business unit, which had previously been the whole company. We set up a mid-range server organization and a high-end organization, and within workstations we had graphics and so forth. And then we had we had Spark, and that began to grow as a separate division, microelectronics, and we had all software. So we had Solaris as one organization, Java as another organization. And so the company suddenly went from a technical workstation company with a VP of marketing, a VP of manufacturing, a VP of sales, to a multi-business, business unit-driven, general manager, business unit-driven organization. And the only two shared functional organizations were global sales and worldwide operations. And then we had began to build off that base.
So some people say that Cisco should not have happened because Sun had a networking strategy that should have taken that business.
Well, you know, that's easy to say.
I know.
I mean, the fact is that, and you can argue that about a lot of things. I also think you can only do so many things.
Yeah.
So if you watch the degree of change and the degree of dynamics that occurs in tech, it's not the way it happens. Now, if you look at IBM, and I might be defensive, but I'm just saying it's not an obvious thing, like somebody went, oh, I screwed up, I should have done that. If you look at IBM in 1970, I don't know what the revenue was, but whatever, you know, 50 billion, 60, whatever it was. You looked at Gartner DataQuest, somebody projection, they projected IBM to be at $400 billion by whatever, 2000. But guess what? Didn't happen, right? And if you look at every, you know, you go from mainframes to departmental processing to desktops to the internet to, you know, mobility and personal devices and so forth, what's the common thread? No company that was successful in one phase has carried through to be successful in the other. So DEC happened, Tandem happened, Compaq happened, Dell happened, different business model approaches. And then what happens after that is there's consolidation. So DEC buys Tandem, gobble. Compaq buys DEC, HP buys Compaq. You know, you watch it. Now you watch what's going on in the chip industry right now. There's incredible consolidation, right? One of the boards I'm on is Altera, and we're in the final stages of an acquisition by Intel. And if you look at the number of microprocessor companies right now, they're getting bought. That's just the way it is, you know. And
so
Cisco had a very focused mission, a strong team, saw what they wanted to do, and they went and did it. Now Sun could have gone and done that, but maybe Cisco would have beaten us out doing it. Who knows?
So you mentioned a cultural shift where, you know, the initial enthusiasm and fun culture, and there was, I read some literature where there was somebody, Nancy, was asked to reinvigorate and became the CEO of
Fun. Yeah, I think we had a
Fun.
Chief officer of Fun or something.
Yeah, yeah. Because Scott felt that company was being a lot
well,
of people.
Well, you know, I compliment Scott and a lot of executives in that they, I think Sun, more than any company I've seen, when it got to be $15, $20 billion, still had a quasi-startup Fun culture. Everybody, if you go talk to Sun people today, they will tell you, best time I ever had in my life. Never worked in a better place, never had more fun. And that was true all the way up to 2001 or whatever when the bubble broke.
And it was a very sad time for people that had to leave or, you know,
that's
the company.
Right.
So you're absolutely right.
Absolutely. And it was truly a unique place.
Right.
No question about it.
So you saw tremendous growth at Sun, and of course you saw the bubble first. Can you describe that experience?
Yeah. Wasn't fun. That was not fun at Sun.
Right.
So just before it broke, I think it's kind of interesting anecdotally. This is a true story. I had my office down in Agnew's, and I was right by, well, Scott was around one side, and Ed was next to me, and I'm sitting there and walk in the office and go, did you look at the stock? I said, no. I said, our market cap this morning is $210 billion. We're bigger than IBM. And then we sat there, holy crap. Now what are we going to do? Because our whole strategy, our whole PR, everything about us was we are the underdog, we're the up and comer and all that. We don't know what to say, you know. And so we had this little period in there where we'd really made it. But if you looked at our customer base, the way we'd done it is through all the newer corporations, the high growth, the service providers, and so forth. But we're growing like 50%. Whereas our big competitors, who were still much, you know, larger in terms of revenue, were IBM, Hewlett Packard, and so forth. And they had a very different customer base. They had a traditional company, so they had General Motors and, you know, all these kinds of people. And I mean, we had them as customers too. They're all heterogeneous environments, but they were the core of their business. So they were maybe only growing 5%. But when the bubble broke, it didn't just break in a generic way. It broke much more severely for the kinds of customers that we had. So like an Exodus or somebody, we might have a company with 30,000 or 40,000 servers in it that just went out of business. And so it hit us much harder. And I will never forget, after that big crash occurred, I had an outlook for the quarter of $5 or $6 billion, and in week seven, which is like a critical week when you kind of reassess your quarter to reset your procurement activities and so forth, my outlook went from, for organizations, our outlook went from $5 or $6 billion to $3 billion. And we went from hiring, we were hiring at a rate of 4,000 or 5,000 people a quarter. We were literally planning and building out a new 5,000 person campus every 3 months. It was unbelievable. We went from that to stopping dead all our expansion, laying off 10,000 people instead of hiring five, beginning to pull back from all of our financial commitments for land and construction of new campuses, and literally slammed the brakes on and stopped on a dime. And it was an incredible experience. And not only the obvious financial and business aspects of it, but just walking the halls. And there's so many young, brilliant young people in Sun. And you know, you would look at them and they were like a deer in headlights. I mean, they were like, what's happened here? You know, their whole career, all they'd experienced was this up ramp. And they had never been through major downturn, and so it was a frightening time.
So you also you wrote an article in the Indiana University Business Journal, which is pretty well read, that the transition took place from Sun's model of the vertical architecture to horizontal, people that were with Linux and Intel products.
Well, I'm sure there'll be people, you know, who don't agree with me, but What happened was somebody wrote an art, three professors wrote some kind of research study, and they used sun as the example. And when I read this thing, this was in Business Horizons, it's kind of like Harvard Business Review, same kind of magazine. They took sun, and they went through this whole explanation of why sun, you know, crashed and all that. And they had it all wrong. And I read it, and I just got aggravated. So I wrote this long email to, I don't think anybody even knows this. I wrote this long email to the editor. And she reads it, and I said, I'm not going to even hear a thing back, but I feel better, you know. And so about a week later, I get an email back, and she says, this is the most unbelievable thing I've ever read. Would you please consider the possibility of converting it to an article? And I said, yeah, sure. So I wrote this thing, and you know, I said, here's what I think, which is completely different from what all these guys think. And then I went through my logic. Basically what I said was, this was not about Sun making mistakes with, you know, it's, I'm trying to remember what they were talking about the low end and about Sun's inability to compete and so forth. And I said that, you know, that's never been Sun's strategy. And what Sun was about and the reason it was successful was Solaris said we have the most highly scalable operating system ever developed, and very robust in parallel with that, and that the power of our RISC chipset was not a unit processor head-to-head competition on a product cost basis with Intel. It was a systems combination, and it was a combination of being able to build a 20, 40, 60, 80, 100 processor machine and marry that with a tuned Solaris operating system that could scale and get the full benefit of the performance of that kind of a machine. And when you had that combination, you could go up against a mainframe or anybody else and deliver incredible performance and incredible cost performance and so forth. And so we went through all that, but and we talked, the other part of it was, I know Scott was pissed at me for a while, he didn't use his name or anything, but I essentially said, you know, we had a leadership vacuum that had a lot to do with the problem. And so I talked a little about that in the article and kind of tried to put it together in a way that was not specific or, you know, critical of any one thing, but rather just kind of explain, hopefully as objectively as possible, what really happened, why it happened, and why it was so difficult to get back out of.
You know, yeah, there certainly have been a lot of people asking that question. I think we certainly.
Yeah, it was interesting, you know, the way that thing evolved. I published the article, and I started getting emails from all over the world, and then the editor said, This article has been read by more people than any article we've ever published. Whoa, that's pretty unbelievable. I only wrote it because I got mad one day.
So, you know, just reading through that, I think some of the things that come out, the reasons for Sun's decline, I think you mentioned slow RIFs, the reduction in force.
Yeah.
Too little, too late, as you said.
Yeah.
Product strategy in terms of what kind of products, competitiveness you mentioned, the Java expenses you mentioned, acquisitions like Storage Tech, MySQL, which was later, open source strategy, giving away things for nothing.
That's a good
and then
list.
You mentioned leadership at top.
Right.
So these are some of the things that.
Those are all true. I mean, we. I think one of the things that happened at Sun in that period was, religion is good, business is good, but it's like America. you know, religion is supposed to be separate from government or whatever, but I think Sun got a little mixed there. You know, the funding 4,000 Java developers with zero revenue was not exactly a good business decision. And that's, you know, you can argue about it all day, but buying very poor acquisition, business acquisition decisions. And, you know, a lot of these things happen because the people who had built the company weren't there anymore. And, you know, the other half of it is, I think, after some decisions are made, the people weren't there to drive changing those decisions, too. You know, it's like when you buy a bad stock, you can, you know, say, well, you know, I'm losing a little money. You pull the trigger and sell it, or you just ride it to the bottom, right? And it looked to me from the outside like they were riding every bad decision to the bottom.
So a lot of people were wondering about selection of Jonathan Schwartz as CEO.
Well, I wasn't there when Jonathan was selected.
Yeah.
So I know Jonathan well, and I knew him as a business development person. And he came in, I think, with the purchase of Lighthouse, and I think he's a brilliant guy. And as he actually attended my staff sometimes, and you know, we looked at a lot of acquisitions. We did a lot of acquisitions, and I think he was very good at that and very smart. You know, what happened when Scott selected him is, I don't know. I wasn't there, so I'm not really.
Right.
I would only be hearsay on my part.
So also in terms of unit prices of performance, as you mentioned, that it was not competitive.
Yeah. Right.
There have been some reaction to that. understandably, for example, UltraSpark won when it was announced that.
Well, if you look at the year of the late 90s, early 2000s, go talk to Neil Knox, who ran the low end server business and the workstation stuff at that point in time. He came into my staff meeting and presented 20 graphs that showed how disadvantaged we were trying to sell a unit processor box and exactly what we could do if we did 2U, you know, and so forth, and how much more competitive we got, and then how we could bring Solaris in to impact that and scale and so forth. But I will challenge anybody that comes in and tells me that a unit process, a single Spark chip at that point in time against Intel was competitive on a price performance basis. It was not.
Also, Millennium, which was the chip that was canceled, was still in fab. In fact, it was completed.
What was?
The Millennium.
Oh, yeah.
Processor.
Right, yeah, Millennium. Yeah.
So that also, there were a lot of questions asked as to why was it done, because it was supposed to work for the cloud computing application, which later on became a very big thing. So something that had reached the fab, you know, was all completed, but at least evaluated. So that was a question asked. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I could only make general comments about it. I'm not, that's not, I think that chips like that are very, very difficult to do.
Yeah.
I mean, it basically comes down to that.
Right.
My basic point has always been that if you look at an E10K, any high-end server, we built up to 105 processors, and then we had clusters, and we were working on, you know, the architecture of that product, the partitionability of the product, the individual domains, the amount of RAS that would real estate that was devoted to RAS combined with the robust scalability of Solaris is what made those world class products. It wasn't a chip. It wasn't any one thing.
Right.
One of the great things we learned from the acquisition was that these guys really understood the IBM mainframe business, and they understood the approach and how much of the real estate in a mainframe is for RAS. And they were shocked. You know, we were shocked when we saw that. Then you've really got to make a major commitment to this, and you've got to devote a lot of resources to it. And if you don't, the number one requirement of any customer in that class of device is high availability. then you got to achieve it through no one thing, but through many things, including, you know, easy failover, right, warm backup, high res, clustering strategies, whatever it takes. And the exact opposite of where Sun started as a company, which was a technical workstation run by an engineer who just loved to tinker with it. Right. So it was an amazing transition by a company.
You've mentioned RAS several times. I'm not sure all our readers of
Reliability, availability, and scalability.
Okay.
And serviceability, I'm sorry.
Right. Just want to make sure that was clear.
So the other disruptor was the clock speed in chips, which caused power problems. And I think many of the people were affected, Sun included, and Intel.
Still a problem.
It's still a problem. So Sun took the position of acquiring Altera to go to multi-threading and multi-core to address that issue. And I think they have succeeded fairly well in that. And other people followed, mm-hmm, you know, including.
Yeah, from what I've heard from talking to you and others is that you know, the number of cores that you're achieving and the whole architecture is amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, it's probably shouldn't say this, but in a way, it's disappointing, or kind of afterwards disappointing, but sad that that kind of technology is sitting there inside Oracle, probably with a lot of governors and limiters on it.
Yeah. So some general questions,
sure,
looking back at the career. When you got stuck with a project, what did you do? I mean, this is a general question.
When I got what?
Stuck with a project.
Stuck with a project?
A problem or a project. You know, had a problem to confront. You know, what was your approach to solving that?
Sure. Well, so I'm going to go up level a little,
sure,
bit on this answer and stop me if it's not what you want. I have a very, I've always, I think, had a consistent leadership style. The first thing I always try to do when I see a problem is I say, I truly believe that there's a pony inside there someplace, and that you make the problem the answer. And I feel that that's what I, after a lot of hard work, we were able to do that with eCash Parity, for example. But I have a fundamental leadership style. It's pretty simple. I believe in total candor. I believe in any time I've ever taken on a new organization, the first thing I do is have a meeting with everybody, and I say, here's what makes me happy, here's what makes me angry, and here's my style. You know, I think everything starts with trust. You have to be totally honest. If you and I agree to a goal, and you're in trouble, get stuck, if you come and talk to me about that as soon as you know it, I have no problem with that. If you wait 6 months until you realize you have no other choice and you come to me, I'm going to really be pissed at you. And always, then other elements are things like always try to think, you know, sit in your boss's shoes and chair and think about solving the problem up a level and what his or her reactions be to that. So on and so forth. And so very much a team approach, very much a, you know, candid, honest approach. I believe the earlier you can address a problem, the more options you have to solve it. And that inside every problem, not only can you solve that problem, but you can use that in a way to make everything else better around it.
You've taken many decisions and tough issues. If you could change or redo an event or decision during your career, what would it be?
If I could change a decision?
Yeah, looking back.
If I could change a decision, what would it be?
Or a choice or whatever?
Choice.
Yeah. Can it be at a personal level?
Whatever.
I would have come to California 20 years earlier. Yeah, it's interesting. I don't digress too much, but I'm a guy who spent a long time on the East Coast, and I worked in technical environment on the East Coast and so forth, and I traveled extensively to California, and I thought through that extensive travel that I had a pretty good sense of what it was like, Silicon Valley, quote, you know, And when I moved here, I realized that I had not had a clue. And that you have to live here to begin to really get a feel for why it's so different and what the secret sauce is. And once you figure it out and you get involved in the middle of it, it is the most exciting place to be on the planet. And I wish I had, figured that out and realized it and then gotten an opportunity to be here probably 20 years earlier in my career. That would have been fabulous. And it's funny, once I got her and I did it, but I was still with a big East Coast company, Xerox, I tried to explain it to people back there and nobody ever got it. And they were really smart people. But they would kind of shake their head and go, well, you know.
Weirdos.
Yeah, weirdos. They knew I was no longer one of them when I went back in January for a board meeting. And I forgot my overcoat and my glasses, and all I had was sunglasses. And I had to do my pitch to the board in my sunglasses. And I had a little suntan. That was the end. Never trusted me.
So after you retired from Sun, of course, you've been very busy. From what I can tell, you've been on the boards of many companies. SonicWall, Altera, Extreme Networks. You've been a trustee emeritus at Hanover College. Indiana University Advisory Board, Dean's Advisory Board. You're also in El Camino Hospital Foundation Board and also the Philanthropy Council. So how has that life transition been for you?
It's been great. I always kid people, you know, and they say, well, you know, are you retired? Well, I say, well, I flunked retirement big time. And what I realized, I got a lot of advice when I made the decision to stop working full-time at Sun. And everybody said, what's gonna happen is you're gonna kind of freak out and go, God, what am I gonna, you know, I've been working here, I work here 7 days a week, essentially, and what am I gonna do with all that time? And you're gonna start, the phone will ring, and you're gonna start accepting all these little things because you're afraid you're not gonna have anything to do. And they said, and actually what's going to happen is the opposite. And a year from now, you're going to be going, why did I ever agree to do any of these things? So the advice was, don't do anything. Just take 6 to 12 months. And I did that. I didn't answer the phone. I didn't try to get involved in anything. I played golf until I hated it. And I realized, you know, I love what I do. I've done it all my life just because I reach a certain point in my life. Why would I stop doing that? Why would I go sit on my couch and watch sports all day or whatever you do? And so I got a phone call from someone who'd worked for me at Sun, who was at SonicWall, and they said, would you be interested in joining the board? And I said no a couple times. And then this was in my sort of sabbatical stage. And then they called again, and I went and had lunch, and they talked me into it. I ended up being the chairman of the board there for 6 or 7 years, and I loved it. It was a whole new life for me. I met things I'd never thought about. A whole new set of friends, you know, a whole new set of people with like interests, and then a great business experience where we made it successful, we built it, we took it private, we made money, and that was kind of my CIT launch of, am I going to want to do things now anymore in my life? And it was such a great experience that I said, I love this stuff. And my, you know, Hanover asked me to go be on the board, and I did that. I did graduate work at Indiana University in Bloomington, and so I became active there, and so now I'm advisory group to the dean. I'm an small advisory group to the Johnson Center for Entrepreneurship. I'm a director on the IU Foundation. And now I've become really involved with the new, exciting, and fast-growing School of Informatics and Computer Science. And we're building a new building. We've taken the thing from 0 students to 2,000 students in like about, gosh,
is that
8
Indiana?
Or 9 years. Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting, another area where we're involved is Stanford with international graduate students, and extensively involved there. And a number of those students who are in computer science at Stanford, IU was their second choice. So I thought that's pretty cool. That says IU is pretty highly ranked. And then I got involved more at Hanover. We canceled the business major there. We didn't think it was appropriate. And we set up a thing called the Business Scholars Program. And this is a track where you do a student has to get accepted into it separately from being in the college. And you do a parallel track learning kind of I call it an application layer, no matter what your major is. You know, some extreme examples, you know, maybe you're a religion major or a, you know, ethics major, but you still got to make a living. So you do this parallel track and you learn all the business skills, you learn the computer skills, you do internships in the summer, and hopefully when you come out with your bachelor's degree, you are employable. And then my wife and I did some other philanthropic things there. And so we're deeply involved there, deeply involved at IU. We're funding a innovation center in the new informatics building that's going to get built, and that's going to tie back directly. And we're creating joint programs with the Kelley School of Business, so you can do a entrepreneurship degree and have some cross courses with the informatics and computer science school. And it's a perfect startup. You actually do things. Work in this lab and right. build things and whatever. Yes. So we're doing all that. And then we're, so a lot of nonprofit work, which I really love. El Camino Philanthropy Council, if anyone's interested, please come see me. Yes. We're trying to build a mental health building and associated programs and Monterey Bay Aquarium. And then UCSF, we're doing a lot of work there with prostate cancer and outreach marketing programs. Outreach, I've done a lot of things with the co-director of the Cancer Center, Dr. Carroll. We've done public radio, national news, ABC, NBC. We've managed to get active surveillance as a non-invasive early stage cancer treatment protocol embedded in the South Bay now, which it was not even offered before. Right. A lot of exciting things there. My wife loves jellyfish, so we're doing things at Monterey Bay Aquarium for jellyfish. I don't know. It's a whole new life, is yes. the answer to your question. In fact, you know, other than being old, I'm probably having more fun now than I've ever had.
Well, you certainly deserve a lot of the honors you have received over the years. In 1996, you received the CEO Leadership Award from Sun. Mm-hmm. 2000, you received the Alumni Achievement Award from Hanover College, and you were named to the Academy of Alumni Fellows, Indiana University. 2001, Brighton High School, Rochester Hall of Fame, and named significant Sigma Chi Chi fraternity, and were selected most recently, just last week, by the Silicon Valley chapter of the Association of Fundraising Professionals. You and your wife were selected for outstanding volunteer fundraising in Silicon Valley.
Thank you.
So congratulations for all of that.
I can't believe that's me.
And I'm sure there's more to come. You have, of course, you have continuing education, with the universities, Stanford, Harvard, MIT. So I had a few questions to ask you that typically for this sake of the future generation, people that are coming up, for the young people. What are you working on now? Anything exciting?
Yeah, can I go back and mention one
sure.
other thing that's along with that question? What happened at Sun was once a year, the top executives, four or five people, would go in and meet, short meeting with Scott and Ed, and they just ask you one question, which was, are you willing to sign up for another 3 or 4 years? And so the year I left, I decided at the end of the fiscal year, June 30th, I'm going to retire. And knowing especially Scott, God bless him, I figured he'd just say, great, everybody knows how Scott is. And they went, no, 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 what'll it take to stay? We don't want you to do it. We don't want you to do it. Will you stay one more year? And they gave me a really nice, you know, incentive to do that.
That's for but 2 years,
said,
right?
Yeah. So they had me stay on my job one more year. And then the second year, they said, you can do anything you want to do. And so to your question, I created a thing called Leadership Institute. And what this did was we handpicked 18 high-potential vice presidents, and their boss had to agree that 25% of their time would go to this development activity. And we worked with them intensively off-site, and then we gave them team project to do, like how should Sun compete with Microsoft? Some question like that. And they had to build a whole recommendation around that. And then we brought in Wall Street people and so forth, and I created a curriculum that would take them from being a highly competent, brilliant VP running, you know, 500 engineers or something, or a sales organization, to someone who could be a senior executive and have the skill, the tool set to go talk to Wall Street, run a business, you know, et cetera, right? Make the strategic decisions for the company.
Right.
And so I did that for a full year, and I have a lot of passion around that. And I have a lot of passion around a thing I called values-based leadership, which you start with your personal values, and you build your leadership style around it, and then you walk the talk, and you're consistent in that. And so that's an area, actually, that's really close to mine.
Fantastic. So I guess the question was, what are you working on now? What exciting project are you working on?
Well, a big thing we already talked about, a lot of my time is going to chairing the Philanthropy Council at El Camino Hospital. We fortunately have some money through a bond measure, but it's going to take roughly $54 million to build this state-of-the-art mental health building on the El Camino campus. And we have a set of associated programs that are going to take about $15 million. And these are, what I've learned in doing my research on this is that it is a very unique place nationally. We could only find a couple of programs in the entire country that were even close to having anything like the capability of El Camino. The Aspire program for high school age, because there's a, as everybody I'm sure knows, there's a cluster of suicides, right. Tremendous pressure on students and so forth. And then mothers, we have a thing called Moms, and this is basically the work with postpartum depression. There are huge problems with mothers that have emotional problems trying to deal with when they have a new baby and so forth. And then we have another set of programs called OATS, which is for elderly people going through major transitions, which can be, you know, losing a partner, illness, whatever it may be. And so my wife and I are devoting a huge amount of time to that. And so far, we've been at it a year, and we're over $6 million, and we're getting good reception and so forth, and it's really been terrific. Second area where I'm working on a lot now is with UCSF, and they're very close to some major breakthroughs in stem cell research, prostate cancer, trying to get the word out about active surveillance and so forth. That's a big area I'm spending time on. I'm hopefully about done with it, but a lot of time on the acquisition of Altera by Intel,
right.
I'm spending time with three or four different startups, just helping them. They've come to me for help, and they're each one's different, very
right.
different.
Right.
But that's exciting. I even have one that's in New Zealand.
Wow.
Yeah, these guys lived in my guest house for a month. They didn't have any money, and I'm sure many people who watch this will know about that. So I'm doing all those things. I have four grandchildren, travel a little bit. I have 200 rose bushes that I take care of myself.
200?
Play a little golf. I got to prune them all. I'm on the pruning season now.
Especially with a drought.
Rose bushes are unique in this area because we have microclimates and they never go dormant. So
right, right.
You kind of have to take care of them differently than you would in most parts of the country.
Yeah.
I don't know, many things. I have I'm very proud of my oldest granddaughter. She's looking at schools, and I'm hoping for Stanford. They're coming out in January. She's looking at Harvard, Stanford. She's just brilliant. I'm very proud of her, and So I want to get her out here. That's my new mission.
So what do you think is the next big challenge for the technology industry?
How to use all the technology that we have in a far more effective, productive way by all people, and as a major tool to solve some of the world's problems. I think we've got a long ways to go with that. I think technology is really interesting. If you go back to, it's always out of phase. With society. If you go back to, you know, major wars, right? The Civil War, they all of a sudden they had all these guns and everything, but the war strategies weren't predicated on that, so all these people got maimed and killed, and it's always out of phase. Technology is always out of phase. So I think we have more technology and brilliant new ideas and computer power, and we should really start figuring out how to solve problems with it.
I think mental illness is quite a challenge.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So it's amazing how archaic so many aspects of our society is, given the tools we have to.
Right.
It just takes time. But.
Yeah. How do you think the computer industry will change in the future?
I think it's already dramatically changed. First of all. And I think it's going to become more and more pervasive. People aren't going to think of it so much as a standalone industry anymore. You know, like, well, there's these companies that build these big computers, and there's these companies that build laptops and so forth. It's going to be pervasive. And I think the technology is going to be a part of the business strategy and product array of every company, whether it's software, you know, or whatever it is. And it's going to be just kind of assumed in everything, whether you're running a government, healthcare, whatever. There's so many huge problems to be solved that are, and these places are still being run in incredibly archaic ways.
Right.
And so I just think it's going to become part of everything.
So the technology jobs will change, right? What kind of?
Absolutely. And I was writing an interesting thing the other day. I don't know who posted it, but somebody posted it, it was on Facebook, and it was a list of 8 or 9 things, and the question at the top was, when is the computer industry going to impact things? And the answer was, it already has. And then they listed, do you see this? They listed these 8 things. So the first one was, the world's largest transportation company owns no cars,
right.
Uber. The world's largest hotel chain owns no hotel rooms, right?
Airbnb.
And then it goes down this list, and you go, wow, amazing.
Right.
And the disintermediation and the new ways of things. I was listening on the radio coming over here about Black Friday, and they're going, I'm not really sure what that means, because really what's going on is everybody's buying everything online, and they don't even know how much. It's just taking off like crazy. And
right. I remember Scott questioning Facebook. You know, it's just a smart email. You know, so what's...
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What call to action would you give to a young person today?
I'm sure many people say this, but I always say, number one, at a personal level, find something that you truly love to do, and then figure out how to make a living at it. And they'll say, "Well, that's great advice, but that's easier said than done." And my response to that is, "Yeah, but it is probably the most important thing you'll do in your life, so it's worth a lot of work to figure it out." And pick something that's relevant to an area where you feel there's a real need, and figure out how you can do it in such a way that you can make money doing it. So many kids are idealistic, and it's wonderful. I mean, you're always idealistic when you're young and you're smart. So they'll go into some field, but they don't think ahead 3 more steps about, how am I going to apply it? What problem am I trying to solve in the world? And how am I going to make a living at it?
Right.
And so think systemically. Think ahead. it's always amazing, and as many people, everybody knows, that many of the most important decisions in your life you make when you have no experience to make them, right? What's your career going to be? What's your education going to be? Who are you going to marry?
Right.
And you look back, you know, years later and you go, wow, you know,
right.
I had it all wrong. I didn't have any experience.
Thank you, John.